plus vacant properties with responsible developers. The leading role in the passage of that legislation was played by Senator David Argall. And as it turns out, after nearly 20 years, some of the most effective land banks are being operated in rural counties, Lackawanna, Somerset, Lancaster, and others. So again, there are areas of commonality and in some cases, opportunities to work across party lines and across regions to come to an appropriate resolution. And then on a micro scale, I serve as judge of elections in my neighborhood. I spent a lot of time this past weekend circulating a flyer that described some of the changes in the election process that had occurred since the November election so that my neighbors would be fully informed about what's going on. And I have a good understanding, a reasonably good understanding of why redistricting is important. My new book, Philadelphia Battlefields, Disruptive Campaigns and Upset Elections in a Changing City, describes several critical redistricting decisions that were made over the past years and is accompanied by some graphics. And I'd like to give this to the commission if that's okay. One candidate who benefited from a particular reapportionment years ago described it as the least illegal way of drawing the lines. That's obviously not where I want us to be. I'd like to suggest that this year we can reach a different outcome. And it's gonna be tough. As you're well aware, many people are inclined to view any new government initiative with distrust. And some people are concerned that redistricting is going to produce real political disadvantages. We don't have to end up that way. And I think there's an opportunity again for us to work together. I know how to do that and would welcome an opportunity to be part of this commission for that purpose. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. You wrote a book about it? You wrote a book about redistricting?
Well, about political campaigns, but clearly redistricting in Pennsylvania has influenced and will influence the outcomes of many campaigns, as you're aware.
Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Maureen Roth.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I am probably the least qualified candidate for this position. I think my license as a counselor lends itself to the chairperson position in that I would work to make the members of the group understand and come together on a cooperative decision. I have also lived in several areas of Pennsylvania. When my husband and I were first married, we lived in Zionsville, which is in Lehigh County. Then we moved to Allentown, which is also in Lehigh County. We currently live in Harrisburg. We lived on the Allison Hill section of Harrisburg. This was when my kids were very small. We recently moved back from Blairsville. We lived in Blairsville, which is in Indiana County for 13 years. So I kind of understand the demographic of Western Pennsylvania. My husband worked in Pittsburgh. When we lived in Harrisburg, he worked in Reading, which is another totally different neighborhood. My grandmother currently lives in the Poconos, which is another whole scheme of things. I am very familiar with most of Pennsylvania. Erie is another area that I would really like to learn more about. Our daughter currently lives in Beaver, which is another whole population of Western Pennsylvania. So I think the different types of communities that are across Pennsylvania lend themselves to a congruency and a wholeness of the citizens of Pennsylvania. And my work as a hospice chaplain was wonderful to get to know people in central Pennsylvania, Lewistown, Center County. Just talking with families, meeting the Amish community there was wonderful. So. And I believe that all of the people of Pennsylvania need to know that their voices are heard as voters, and that includes those in urban and rural and suburban settings. So I welcome any questions you have.
You know, you did nail it, that we are all over the state, and we all represent different kinds of constituencies, and that's something that should be considered with the redistricting, right? Keeping groups.
Seeing that we're losing probably at least one, if not two, seats in the House of Representatives, according to the new census numbers that came out yesterday.
Yeah. I think we're going to lose one congressman.
Yeah.
I think we're going to lose a congressman. Yeah. Are there any questions?
Just a comment. I agree, I think, with Senator Ward. I think that you've demonstrated your breadth of experiences living in different parts of Pennsylvania, which I think is something. And I disagree with your comment that you're the least qualified, because I think you are
somebody who
I think we need to be looking at through this process. So I appreciate your time here and appreciate the work you've been doing.
Sure.
So thank you very much.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Oh, I didn't see you. No, sorry.
I'm at the far end.
Yes.
Excuse me, Madam Chair. I also wanted to say, you know, don't start another interview saying that, because as I look over, you know, again, your resume and all the schooling you've had and the vast experiences you've had serving, whether it's inside a hospital or other, I mean, those are really significant experiences. So we really appreciate your leadership and
even putting
forth your name, going through the application process and coming down today to talk to us. So thank you so very much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Next on, we're going to start Zooms now, and we have Frederick Murphy.
Hello. Thank you for allowing me to testify. This has been an interesting experience. Let me summarize my qualifications. I understand the technical issues of mapping and redistricting. I have actually published research papers in the area, and I've been involved in looking at redistricting issues since 2007. And I've actually won a contest on producing the most compact map for the city of Philadelphia. And I've been involved with Common Cause and its redistricting committee for over a decade now. Another qualification I have is long experience in public policy analysis. During the energy crisis years, when the legislation was going through, I was actually running the forecasting systems of the Department of Energy. I'm not that old. I was 31 when I was doing that. And that was producing the numbers that the Congress people were using to make their decisions on the energy legislation. And I've been involved in energy for a lot of years. Most recently, after I retired from Temple, I commuted to Saudi Arabia for several years and through 2018, where I learned the differences between policymaking in a democracy and an absolute monarchy. And that was quite an experience to see that different world. I've also been involved in a lot of other policy analysis issues. I was an advisor to the Tax Reform Commission in Philadelphia that led to the substantial reductions in the wage tax that have helped the city economy recover. I advised PGW on the Customer Responsibility Program back when natural gas prices were high and it looked like there was the potential for it bankrupting PGW. I would look forward to helping in this process in any way I can, because clearly I've managed in highly political environments. It was remarkable being in Washington during those crisis years and seeing how the Tax Reform Commission had to negotiate its public presence. And the other thing is that I've led teams where it's both public policy and the sensitivity one has to have to public policy issues, yet also dealing with deeply technical issues. And so I'm looking forward to, if you select me, to contribute to an open process that is accepted by all Pennsylvanians. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. We have any questions here from the panel? Yes, Representative Benninghoff.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. Thank you for bringing your comments to us in paper ahead of time. I did read over them. You had said that you've been a member of Common Cause. Are you still a member of that organization or any other kind of political action committee?
I'm a part of Common Cause as a member of the redistricting committee. I don't get involved in the other issues related to Common Cause.
One other quick question, if I may. You have obviously extensive experience and resume. A lot of it seems to be based in the urban areas of our Commonwealth. How do you strike as a chairman the balance between those experiences, life experiences, and education with the interests of rural Pennsylvania, which is, you know, the kind of the heart of the tea?
Well, one of the research projects we undertook with some colleagues was to actually go around and interview people. So we did a few interviews in the rural areas to catch the key interests of the people in the rural areas. And what we found was very interesting. In the urban areas, people focused on compactness. In the rural areas, people are concerned about having their political districts split and the smaller towns and metropolitan areas losing their ability to have voice in the state legislature. So what's critical is to balance those interests and reflect those needs. And in doing a lot of mapping for Common Cause and on my own, it's very clear that one has to balance the interests of the different communities in the state.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Oh, okay, anyone else before? Okay, thank you very much, sir. Next on the list is Myra Forrest. You may be muted, Ms. Forrest. You may be muted.
Good morning, Senators Costa and Ward and Representatives Benninghoff and McClinton. My name's Dr. Myra Forrest. I'm honored to be here as a candidate for the chairperson of the Legislative Reapportionment Committee. I am a lifelong educator, a teacher, principal, director of curriculum, assistant superintendent, college professor at three different universities, executive director of an education foundation, and an education advocate for a health and wellness foundation. In these various positions, I've been a leader and have been able to bring groups to consensus. I've always loved working with people, assisting them with solving problems, and all of these occupations have offered me that opportunity. I believe helping our fellow man is why we are here on this earth. During my career, I've served on numerous boards and have become the chair of many of them. I'm going to share some of those experiences with you. In June 2020, my 9-year board member commitment came to an end at the Pottstown Area Health and Wellness Foundation. And for the last 3 years of being on that board, I was the chair. I'm the chair of the board of the trustees of the Pottstown Hospital Tower Health. I'm active in my church and serve as both the church pianist and as the church moderator, as well as being the director of Bible school and the director of children's choir quite a number of years ago. I served as vice president of the Montgomery County Office of Children and Youth Advisory Board, which is a position appointed by county supervisors. I also served as president of the board of directors of a professional orchestra, the Pottstown Symphony, for 17 years, as well as being the keyboard player for the symphony. Playing in an orchestra is the ultimate example of teamwork. Everyone needs to work and think together the entire time in order to have a successful outcome. The topic of redistricting is very important to me. I believe it is a totally nonpartisan issue. As a former school district superintendent, I've dealt with many redistricting many times, and the hand-wringing and worry that parents go through when their child needs to attend a new school. I cannot tell you how many school board meetings were attended by upset parents, contemplating the terrible fate that their child would come to if they were moved to a different school. The parents were nervous wreck, and the children fell in love with their new school on the very first day. All the angst and the anger from redistricting magically disappeared, and the parents wrote letters to me about how wonderful the new school was and thanked me for the decisions that were made. I've experienced firsthand unfair district boundaries by merely being an employee in the small town of Pottstown in Montgomery County for a number of years. The town is only 5.5 square miles, yet it's divided in half by inappropriate districting. It has two state representatives of two different parties, to the point that even one of the wards is divided in half. This serves no purpose, and the people of the town are not well represented by this process. I would like to see a fair solution put in place that could better assist all the residents of the state of Pennsylvania. My own family is representative of the entire state. My maternal grandfather was born in Pittsburgh, where his entire family resides. My family was born in a small town called Snowshoe, which is in Center County. My paternal grandmother and grandfather, respectively, were born in Howard and Bellefonte in Center County. My mother, maternal grandmother, and I were born in Delaware County. I was born at Fitzgerald Mercy Hospital in Darby, and my husband was born in Hahnemann Hospital in Philadelphia, and both of our children were born in Montgomery County. I have a very broad and deep interest in every section of this great state and want its people to be fairly and justly represented. Thank you again for the opportunity to speak with you. The processes of reapportionment and redistricting are very important and a serious commitment to the people of Pennsylvania. During my career, as well as all my work on boards, I have worked successfully with people on both sides of the aisle representing both political parties. I know I could be a fair, just, ethical, and amicable chair of this committee, and believe I have the background and demeanor to bring people to compromise and consensus. Again, thank you for the time you have provided for me to speak today.
Any questions? Thank you very much. Next is Christopher Fowler.
Thank you. I'm assuming everyone can hear. Thank you first to the commission for having us here. I applaud your efforts at creating an open and transparent committee. I think this is a wonderful first step. My name is Chris Fowler. I'm associate professor of geography and demography here at Penn State, where we are limping to a bittersweet conclusion to what has been a very challenging school year. I'm here for one thing, and that's representation. And I want to say thanks to Representative Benninghoff for questioning the term fair from the get-go, because it is a loaded term. And I think you all are here to provide fairness, because fairness implies a set of parties who have vested interest that need to be balanced. My vision for this committee is to serve representation, to make sure that the voters, people of the Commonwealth, have that representation through their districting. And I want to give you some of the basis for my concern about that. 3 years ago, my class, Geography 426, went out and surveyed people in Pennsylvania about what they wanted in their maps. Before sitting down to draw our own, we wanted to know what the voters wanted. And so we went to the tailgate at the OSU Penn State football game and asked voters from all over the Commonwealth what they wanted. There was one thing they all agreed on, which was that Penn State should beat OSU. Other than that, they were all over the place. They wanted competitive, compact, representative, non-boundary splitting things. No perfect map exists. No perfect map is possible. And if we make a very competitive map in this current polarized political climate, you're going to have a lot of people who feel like they lost by 1% and their views aren't being represented, okay? This is the difference between fairness and representation. What can we do to incentivize legislators to serve their electorate? What can we do to make it in their best interests to give the best service they possibly can? And I think that can be done partially through good maps. I really do. If we have a homogenous district where everyone thinks the same way and votes the same way, there aren't incentives for a representative to do good service because they're not at risk of losing their job if they don't. Conversely, if we have a really competitive district, in the current political climate, there's all the incentive is to get your base out and shut the other person's down. That doesn't lead to good representation either, because you have people who are left out. So what can we do to change the districting process to make people feel included and to make it so that the legislators themselves are responding to their constituents? That's why I'm here. That's what I want to do. My experience in this regard, my whole life's work is about helping people draw boundaries that produce outcomes that are beneficial. I've worked with planning and zoning committees. I've worked with school districts. I've worked with the census on how they draw tracts and blocks. I've worked with the Office of Management and Budget on defining urban. I've worked with I always have to look at the acronym, Health Resources Services Administration, on how to define rural. These things are critical. The way we draw those boundaries, where those boundaries get drawn, shape billions and billions of dollars in policy. And I've been there, looking at rural, looking at urban, looking at schools, looking at neighborhoods, yes, even looking at legislative districts. Okay, this is the experience I bring, and it is someone who wants to see a good outcome. Not the perfect outcome, I don't think that's possible, but a good outcome that increases representation. In terms of what I can offer to the committee, I do have expertise in all the things, expertise with data, expertise with methods and metrics, all the things. I teach mapping, this is what I do. But beyond that, I also know who the people are out there who do a really good job doing that, who the experts in these fields truly are. One thing I want to mention, I do have particular detailed knowledge on the differential privacy tools that the census is using, or at least proposing to use, in the redistricting data. I can say right now that the quality of that data is going to be very different from what's been provided in the past by census, and it's a non-significant issue to figure out how we get good districts drawn with less than perfect data. So again, representation is my thing. This is what I have to offer, is a lifetime, 20 plus years spent helping people draw better maps. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Do we have any questions? No, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fowler. First of all, obviously you can tell you're very sincere about these comments. Prefacing it with a win of PSU over OSU is always a good place to start. I like the fact you differentiate between fairness and representation, not that they're not interchangeable, but I think it is hard for the average person to understand when they hear this dialogue about fair, fair, fair. You know, I've represented several different districts because I came in midstream one time, and I often tell people that come to talk to me about this, no squiggly line in a map dictates who I take care of. We take care of many people that don't live in our district. I get calls from all over the state, and we have people coming in from the neighboring district. Sometimes it's by geography I'm just closer to get to, or the fact that I've been blessed with great staff that gives good service. So at the end of the day, I would just close with that our members, I can't speak for the rest of the panel, but I think they concur that, you know, we are here to be in the service business. We want to help people. Our goal is to try to get maps drawn out. We encourage you to continue to share some of your knowledge, obviously. I want to close on one comment you made, and it's not a perfect process when you're trying to target a population number, which is one of the guidelines, be compact, and deal with geographic boundaries. If you look at the Pennsylvania maps, which I suspect you already have, you know, the size of the geography of these districts are significantly different as you move more towards urban areas. Some of my friends in the urban areas, I joke, because they can walk across their district in 3 hours, you know, it would take me 3 days. And some of my friends up in the north, you know, they have to have multiple counties. And that is not done because we want to make squiggly line maps. And the members are traveling pretty good distances to do that. So I just want to give you the reassurance. I appreciate your sincerity that we are keeping all that stuff in mind as we go through this process. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, and thank you, sir. Next on the list is Gerald Grupp.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak with you today and to provide you with an understanding of my capabilities and experience as it relates to the legislative redistricting task ahead. The last 30 years of my 40-year professional career were supporting clinical research. My responsibilities focused primarily on implementing technology to gather and manage data, which improve the speed, quality, and safety of the conduct of clinical trials. And some of those efforts have been incorporated in the trials which supported the recent vaccine approvals. Today, I want to focus on my public service as a school board director for the Council Rock School District in Bucks County from March 2000 to January 2019. I joined that board because I was interested in ensuring good education for the children of our district. During my term, I never treated it as a political position. It wasn't about party, it was about delivery. In that role, I was one of nine members whose authority only came when we acted together. As in the role under consideration today, all the members of the committee were peers. Our authority only came when a majority came to agreement on an item. And like the reapportionment commission, my board was made up of people with different backgrounds, life experiences, and political affiliations. Our decisions were based on law and our own informed individual assessment of what was best for our community. And by community, building upon what Representative Benninghoff had said, I mean the entire school district, not the individual region in which we were each elected or from which we were each elected. On that board, there are two specific instances that I want to that have direct application on the task laying ahead of the commission. In 2002, there was a legal challenge regarding the boundaries of the voting districts from which the nine board members were elected. The law requires that the voting districts be of approximately equal size. One region had grown to 29,000 electors, and two other regions had only 1,200 electors. To comply with law, we needed to create nine districts of roughly equal numbers of electors or some other plan providing equal representation of the electors. Some of the constraints we faced are similar to what will confront the commission. We had to create voting boundaries with lines that did not split voting districts or wards. We had nine sitting elected school board directors with staggered terms, some of whom would be up for re-election in the next municipal cycle, and others with two more years in their terms. Various groups within our communities felt the realignment of boundaries meant they'd lose representation, and others saw it as an opportunity to gain representation. And we had to meet publicly. Any meeting of a quorum of the board had to be advertised, a public meeting. And the board approved realignment plan would have to be confirmed by a court. We were able to develop a plan which met the general acceptance of the community and was approved by the court. The second related experience came in 2018. As part of our capital planning efforts, we needed to realign what students in school and needed to realign the students in the schools. This meant evaluating the current and planned capacity for the 10 elementary schools, two middle schools, and two high schools. With over 11,000 K to 12 students, our challenge was large and complicated like the ones the commission faces today. A little different than the commission faces, we had to consider projections for future changes in the population, not only the number today, but also as it grew and as children came in because of aging in, aging out. Some of the constraints we faced there were, we were potentially moving families from schools where they might have had a long family association or had purchased a home in a specific sending area because they wanted their children to attend a specific school. We had to account for families where there was a possibility older children from that family might still be going to the different school than their younger siblings, since we wanted to minimize disruption to the upper level primary grades. We wanted to keep additional bus transportation costs to a minimum. We received a great deal of public input, ranging from items or aspects which we should consider up to and including detailed and alternate sending plans. It wasn't just receiving input, it had to be reading, interpreting, and weighing the value of each alternate plan and incorporating parts of that into ours. We held public meetings to present our plans and receive feedback. Emotions in the public ran high. Many people bought in the district specifically for the schools and now had an incredible dedication to the schools in which they were familiar. And we wanted to respect cultural aggregations within our communities and the different nature of our communities and municipalities. At that same time, our new boundaries could not be discriminatory to any age, any groups or individuals. Ultimately, we were successful and implemented a plan which became the basis for the new sending areas within our school districts. So as you can see, having been a longtime leader in a successful district, I have a proven track record of working with others as one of a group of equals, creating a creative problem solving while in the public eye, receiving, evaluating, and incorporating public feedback on proposed plans, complying with the rules and regulations which relate to how to realign sending voting or voting districts, communicating to stakeholders in a manner that is both open and informative, and driving towards consensus with my team but not afraid to make tough decisions when necessary. And so I have offered my services to serve as the chair of the Legislative Redistricting Committee and hope that I'll have the opportunity to work with you to serve the citizens of the Commonwealth in this important task. Thanks again for letting me address the commission today. Parenthetically, I will mention that I grew up in Allegheny County, went to school at Penn State, lived for 20 years or so up in Bucks County, and have recently moved to Philadelphia. Any questions, I'm glad to answer.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Thank you very much, Mr. Grubb. Next on our list is Joe Lynn.
Good morning, Senator Ward, Representative Benninghoff, Senator Costa, and Representative McClinton. My name is Joe Lynn. I stand, or rather sit, before you today as a child of immigrants raised in the middle-class suburbs who went off to college in the big city. Like many in my generation, I graduated into the big recession and, despite student loan debt, turned away from making money in order to make a difference. Not that there were that many opportunities to make money having graduated into the recession and all. I was a real average Joe among my peers, you might say. I worked for community-based nonprofit organizations and in local government, trying to move the needle on issues like homelessness and hunger. But as you well know, those issues stayed persistent and many times actually got worse. But then I had a chance to work on something that might actually move the needle on those issues and so many others. A chance for everyone who had ever been homeless or hungry before to matter, to count. My role was to lead a coalition of nonprofit organizations to ensure that the 2020 census counted everyone, especially that the folks those nonprofits served. Not only the homeless and the hungry, but the renters, the single parent households, the elderly and homebound, the working poor, all too often in communities of color. These were coincidentally the same populations that the Census Bureau has undercounted cycle after cycle. The discounting of marginalized people has literally hurt our bottom line, giving us a smaller slice of the $883 billion of federal funds that are distributed every year to states based on census data and through programs and grants to local communities. So the stakes were high to get this once in a decade census right, to make sure folks mattered in dollars and in common sense. And it wasn't lost on me that the people that would be missed by the Census Bureau were people that looked like me. People like my mother, who works the swing shift at the USPS mail sorting facility, her overtime shifts and pinching of every penny what gave me a college education. My mother, who only fills out the government forms she has sought out herself, who double checks with me before going through any online process. People like my grandfather, mostly homebound now in his 70s since gout ravaged his extremities. My grandfather, who has never personally filled out a government form as he is unable to read in English, though he did manage to become a citizen after over 20 years of residency, waving a tiny American flag with tears in his eyes. People like me, like my mother, like my grandfather, are all over Pennsylvania. And through Keystone Counts, the coalition of nonprofits I led for 2 years, we were able to reach out to 405,381 households of color filled with people just like them, just like me. People who work too hard to survive, people who know only work and family and community, people who have felt not quite fully accepted in our society for far too long. So I knew I had to be here today on behalf of all the people that we got counted, because redistricting is the next step of the census. Every person who got counted enables additional funding to come to Pennsylvania from the federal government, and every single one of them needs to be accounted for when the LRC is drawing districts. Because how are we to tell people that they matter, that they count, if they're not being represented? And remember, each of those 405,381 households we spoke to directly, either in person by knocking on their door or over the phone by texting and calling them, they started out being hesitant or even unaware of the census until we shared how it would affect them and their communities. It's through these conversations that folks overwhelmingly chose to get counted for their communities to receive funding and representation. Again, these are the folks like my mother, like my grandfather, who have never and will never sit down for a policy wonky debate over mapping criteria like compactness or contiguity. To them, compactness is squeezing all of the family members into a vehicle, and contiguity is mapping a carpool route that includes all of the cousins. And you know what? It shouldn't have to be any deeper than that, because they, like the 405,381 households we spoke to, know who they belong with. In other words, they know their community of interest. And I'm here to ensure their voices are heard, whether it's as chair of this commission or anywhere else. Thank you.
Thank you. So you actually went out and found people. They think it's great, everybody should count. I agree with you, but there's some passion there with you. So you actually went out and found folks?
That's right. So through Keystone Counts, this coalition of nonprofit organizations, 100 nonprofit organizations, we were able to coordinate amongst all of these nonprofits that decided to participate in our field campaign. So we, each nonprofit actually had teams of canvassers pre-pandemic that would go out and knock on doors of folks living in what the Census Bureau calls hard to count census tracts, because we wanted to reach those that were least likely to be counted by the Census Bureau.
Well, that is some good work. That is some good work. Senator Costa.
Thank you very much. So in those hard to count folks, was it normally in urban settings, or was it rural, suburban Pennsylvania as well?
So I would say all over Pennsylvania, there are these hard to count census tracts, and there are various reasons why somebody may be easily missed by the Census Bureau. It could be that their address has changed. It could be that they don't have a mailbox at their residence. It could be that they rent and are under the impression that only people who own homes can participate in the census. So really everywhere in Pennsylvania.
If you were chosen for this position, would you be able to step away from the work you're currently doing to be able to work with us for 14 or so months through this
Absolutely.
Process?
Yes.
So thank you very much for the work you did. I think it will have a long-lasting impact in terms of getting folks counted, as you described, what it means to resource-wise, in particular, as it relates to programs and the like. So thank you for doing that. Thank you for being here
today.
Thank
you, Senator.
Any other questions? Thank you very much. Next on the list, we have Ken McBain. Is he here on, did he come here? Okay, Mr. McBain is not here. So next we'll have David Thornburg.
Thank you, leaders of the LRC. It's quite a pleasure to be with you today and to share thoughts along with a lot of other distinguished and active Pennsylvania citizens. I don't need to tell you how important this process is, but I was reminded of that yesterday. I was in the Heinz History Center in Pittsburgh, which has a great new exhibit on the development of our democracy here in this country since its founding. And it reminds us that representation is always a never-ending challenge. And there's tension built in. There are no perfect outcomes. There are no perfect results. But in the great example of the American experiment, we have to keep on trying to improve the way in which our democracy works. And this redistricting process is certainly a vital part of that. We're also in a period of time in our nation's history and our Commonwealth's history where there are lots of questions being asked about our democratic process. And there is an enormous challenge we have in front of us to restore people's trust in that process. And I think this redistricting process that will unfold in the next 14 months, again, is a key pillar in that challenge. We do have an opportunity, though, in front of us. And this is one I would like to be a part of realizing as the fifth member and chair of the LRC. And that's to carry out the most transparent and accessible redistricting process in our history. Because I truly believe, based on my experience with this issue, that if we do that, we will go a long way towards moving people to a greater sense of trust and faith in the way our democracy works. So let me make three points about my experience that I think prepares me well for this role. First of all, I think I know this issue pretty well. 2 years ago, I served as chair of the Pennsylvania Redistricting Reform Commission with, among others, Senator Costa and his then colleague, Representative Dermody. And we spent an awful lot of time talking to people around the Commonwealth about what they wanted to see in the way that the maps were drawn. We made nine stops, talked to close to 900 people. We did an extensive online opinion survey, thanks to one of the commissioners who's chair of the political science department at Penn State. And that resulted in a report that we're very proud of that I think made some critical suggestions about how the process could be improved. I've also, through my role as president and CEO of the Committee of 70, led the Draw the Lines PA effort over the last 3 years, which is a biannual competition for average citizens to literally pick up the digital pen and draw their own maps for themselves. And we've engaged over 6,000 Pennsylvanians in that process. We have formed from them a core group of about 50 members of what we call the Citizen Map Corps. And I've had lots and lots of conversations with those folks that affirm my sense and confidence that the people of Pennsylvania are ready, willing, and able to contribute to this process. It's also, along the way, I think, left me with some important lessons. I think there is a great despair and distrust, honestly, about how this process has unfolded in the past. Gerrymandering was once an obscure phrase that I think has become a lot more familiar to people, and they have a sense that it contributes to the cynicism and dysfunction and disengagement that we too often see. It also reminds me that citizens care deeply about their vote and their communities. Pennsylvania, as I know well and you know well, is a network of small communities and small municipalities all over the Commonwealth, and people find great comfort and identity in those places and don't like to see those sliced and diced by the mapping process. Finally, I think there's a clearly a realization when you talk with citizens that they understand that there are no such thing as perfect maps, but as I said at the outset, the continuous pursuit of better is what this country is all about. And I think we have that opportunity in front of us here. Second point I'd like to make is I think I know Pennsylvania pretty well. I lived the first 20 years of my life in Pittsburgh. I've lived 35 years in Philadelphia. Through the generations of my family, I have deep roots in rural Pennsylvania. My wife is a native of Hollidaysburg in Blair County. I spent many, many years there with her and her family. And I have, I think, an unusual appreciation of the complexities, political and social and cultural, all of them wonderful, of this Commonwealth. I mentioned the Redistricting Commission tour in 2019 that I think gave me some important insights into the process. We were actually just on the last leg of another tour of the Commonwealth with a similar purpose of educating people around this issue. This is, you may have seen some reference to the great Volkswagen tour of Pennsylvania, where we've made 46 stops around the Commonwealth, racked up over 2,000 miles, everywhere from Clark's Summit to Titusville to Shippensburg and everywhere in between, talking to people in communities about this issue of redistricting and what they'd like to see from it next time around. Finally, you have my full commitment to do this job with integrity and a commitment to process, consensus, and accountability. I hope I demonstrated that, and I hope Senator Costa can vouch for me in the Reform Commission process in 2019. My background, which often involved intersection with members of the business community, I think confirmed my sense that good process produces good outcomes. So I would want to make sure we have not only a transparent and accessible process, but one that produces accountability.
Thank you, and Mr. Thornburg. Are there any questions?
Just a comment. Mr. Thornburg, thank you very much for your testimony today, and more importantly, for the work that you've done over the course of the past several years. You have certainly heightened the awareness of, as you indicated, the term gerrymandering in the process, and most importantly, collectively, as we work, whether we select a fifth person or not, this commission must work to ensure that our process is open and transparent and accountable. And that's the goal of this commission going forward. And I think that's something that you've highlighted in terms of making sure that we do that in terms of ensuring the trust of the public through this process. And I think your work has helped lead to that point, and I appreciate your time today, and thank you very much for being willing to participate in this process again. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
Any other comments or questions for Mr. Thornburg? Thank you, sir. Next is, and last is Joseph Venti.
Good morning, honorable members of the commission. My name is Joseph Venti. I'm an attorney in Philadelphia, and I'm here speaking to you today because I want to be the chair of the Legislative Reapportionment Commission. I should be the next LRC chair if the committee is looking for real commitment to the job. If selected, the chairship would be my sole professional endeavor for the duration of the work at hand. I should be the next chair of the LRC because I have a distinct understanding of neutral decision-making. That understanding is informed by things like successful mediation of around 100 disputes in county court, serving as an arbitrator at the Court of Common Pleas here in Philadelphia, and 9 years of providing objective, dispassionate assessment of contentious legal issues for a federal appeals court. I should be the next chair if the commission is looking for an even temperament. Disagreements will be part of the job. They may even be most of the job, but I understand the importance of disagreement without being disagreeable and of finding common ground if you look hard enough, because it is there. I should be the next chair of the LRC if the commission is looking for a chair who's vehemently nonpartisan. And I believe that this is my most important qualification. I say most important because the issue of redistricting has never been more politically divisive. So the time is now to choose a chair with no present or future political affiliation or ambition, no past campaigns for office, no past work as a lobbyist, no campaign contributions to speak of. I fit that description. In fact, I meet all the criteria set forth in Senator Argyll's recent bill, SB 441. I should be the next chair of the LRC because I believe that the Reynolds v. Sims directive of one person, one vote means what it says. The goal should not be to keep one legislature for one district for one's lifetime. The goal should have nothing to do with partisan advantage on either side, nor geographic advantage. The goal is to serve the people, to give them best representation that we can. As chair, I would encourage a shared commitment to certain guiding principles and priorities, including maximum feasible transparency, think more public meetings, greater digital access to the data that we're using, real online engagement, you know, meet the people where they're at, as well as concerted effort toward LRC unanimity at each turn in the process. If the LRC gets this right, we won't be able to avoid all litigation, but perhaps we can avoid years of costly litigation and map revision, as in years past, and Pennsylvanians will know sooner rather than later who will be properly serving their interests in the General Assembly. More importantly, the LRC could deliver a product that Pennsylvanians will trust. I believe that's what the people of the Commonwealth want and what they deserve, and I hope to play a part in making that happen. Thank you for your time. I yield the balance of mine.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions or comments? Yes, Representative Benninghoff.
Thank you, sir. I'm just curious what your knowledge and interest is in the rural parts of Pennsylvania as we try to have maps that are fair all across the Commonwealth.
Thank you for the question. The interest is in Pennsylvania as a whole. And I don't look at it as a rural versus urban issue, although those are certainly components of the process. I think the chair should be focused on the entire state. So the representation, one person, one vote, that one person lives in Erie County, that one person lives in Philadelphia County, that person lives in Greene County. They live all over the state and they are equal in terms of the representation, the fair representation that we need to try and achieve.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. So that concludes our applicants for right now. And in concert with past practice of the Legislative Reapportionment Commissions, we will now take a short recess for the purpose of an executive session pursuant to Section 708A1 of the Sunshine Act. We'll be back. Thank you.